Welcome to Centerpoint Church. We are so happy that you tuned in for our service today. You can expect a life-giving message from one of our pastors, and then you can also expect some worship music. We hope you enjoy.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Centerpoint Church. I'm glad you guys are all here. Man, it's beautiful out, isn't it? It's crazy. I love it. The spring is coming. We're going to sing some songs. I want you to realize this is totally a safe place. This is like your car. You can sing as loud. You can move as much or as little as you want to. Just sing with me. Sing loud. Let's all stand up.
Love is mighty, it's so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who makes this whole earth with holy thunder? Who leads us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a beguiling love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. For me, yeah. We'll bring the chaos back into order. We'll mix it over, a son and daughter. The King of glory, the King of glory. Who brings the patience, the truth and justice. Who shines the sun. All of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, yeah. That you would bear my cross. But worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Come on. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unbeggarly love. That you would take my place.
This next song, Evidence, a little chiller of a song, but there's so much truth in it. All throughout my history, your faithfulness has walked beside me. When a storm has made way for spring, in every season, from where I'm standing, I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see the promises of fulfillment. And you always will be. I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see the promises in fulfillment. Because of you, oh Jesus, I see the cross, the empty grave, the evidence is endless. All my sins roll away because of you, oh Jesus. Oh yeah, I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life. We have no reason to fear anything in this world. We have a God that is so above it all. Welcome to his house. 2, 3, 4. On this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. It looks to me like weakness is the canvas of your strength. And my story isn't over, it's my story's just begun. And these failures won't define me, that's what my father does. My failures won't define me, that's what my father does. Come on. not the end game. The journey's where you are. You never wanted perfect, you just wanted my heart. If the story isn't over, if the story isn't good, if failure's never final when the father's in the room. The failure's never final when the father's in the room. Check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, here in the Father's house, give me some. Widows come home, the helpless find home. Love is on the move when the God is in the room. Prison guards come by and the dead come to life. Love is on the move when the God is in the room. Come on! The miracles take place in the cynical time bell. Love them breaking the gloom when the God is in the room. The Jericho's walls. Check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, yeah, yeah. In your Father's house. Oh, isn't that amazing? I love these songs because they just tell me where I sit in everything. We're backed up. Just pray with me. Dear Lord, just thank you so much for praise. For worship. It just gives me and all of us a chance to find you and just know how much you have to give us. Thank you for all the promises, and thank you for all of that fulfillment. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to Centerpoint. My name is Sydney and I'm so excited that you're here this morning. If you are new or just have been coming a while but haven't been getting our weekly email, I encourage you to fill out the Connect card in the seat back in front of you. You can fill that out and then you can get that weekly email update, or we can get you plugged in here at Centerpoint, or you could meet up with Pastor Aaron if you want to. Coming up, we are having a blood drive on Good Friday, which is April 2nd, so you can sign up at the Welcome Center out in the foyer if you are interested in that. And then Easter is just 2 weeks away, and we are so excited. We are having a giant celebration here at Centerpoint. It's going to be amazing. Easter is a time that a lot of people are open to coming to church, but they need an invitation. So we have invite cards also in the seat back in front of you. So take a bunch of those, give them to your friends, your coworkers, your family members, and have them come. They have 3 options to come, as do you. We're having a Saturday service, and then we're also having 2 Sunday services at 9 and at 10:30. So our plan for Saturday is, before the Saturday service at 5 p.m., we are having an Easter egg hunt for kids. We'll have cornhole for the adults, and then we'll have pizza for everyone. It's going to be so much fun. And then after the egg hunt at 6 o'clock, the service will be right in the same place. Then Sunday morning, we're going to have 2 services at 9 and 10:30.
We hope to see you there, and we hope that you bring tons and tons of friends. It's going to be awesome. Then lastly, this weekend is different. So we are giving away 3 Centerpoint t-shirts, which is awesome. It's going to be so excited. We have kids sizes, we have women's sizes, and we have unisex sizes for everybody. So if you're here, grab a shirt on your way out and have a wonderful Sunday. Enjoy the service.
If you can hear this message, listen closely. To the exiled, misunderstood, or upside down, this is your message of hope. When problems come, use them. When enemies persecute you, love them. These struggles are a fire, refining you into gold. Look around. You are not forgotten. You are not alone. Challenge what is expected of you. This world is not your home. You are different.
Well, good morning. Welcome to Centerpoint Church. If you're wondering, there are still some seats in the front. So if you want some more room, come on up. Come join me. But anyways, welcome to Centerpoint Church. My name's Aaron. I'm the pastor here. Thanks for checking out our one-hour service of still what I like to say is a very new church. Our mission here is to help you take the next step in your relationship with God, whether that means it's giving you a place to pop in and take off, whether that means helping you start a relationship with God, whether that means helping you mature and grow in your relationship with Him. We want to help you take your next step. This week, we're continuing our newer series called Different, and as part of that series, we're making each Sunday different here at Centerpoint for this last month. So, and in a fun, special, kind of unique way. So it started with mochas. Last week was shamrock shakes. They were delicious, weren't they, if you were here? Yeah, shamrock shakes. And this week we're giving away Centerpoint t-shirts. This is what they look like. Yeah, and you can see it up on the screen. Grab one. It's going to be awesome. The only like prerequisite is like don't commit a crime with them. That would be amazing if you didn't do that. That would be like totally not what we're going for at all. But yeah, the shirts are great, but the sizes are a bit tighter. So just like don't feel offended if someone's like, maybe you want the next size up. And don't start thinking like, oh, maybe it was that shamrock shake from last week. Or no, it's none of that. They're just a little smaller shirts. So anyways, they're unisex, and then there's some women's ones, only a few of those, and then there's kids ones in 2 different colors. So grab one on your way out. They're free, but again, don't commit a crime in those. All right, awesome. We hope, though, that these are just plain old fun church differences that go along with our series, Different. Anyways, our series, Different, is on how a Christian or someone who is a God follower should honestly be different, meaning different than the world or people who are not followers of God. If Jesus is this guide or this model for his followers, a follower of him should be like him and different in how he was. Your understanding of faith should be different, or how you respond to trials and crummy situations, that should be different. How you like choose what to do with your life and your calling should all be different than those who don't see him as a guide. And to be real, I'm excited to continue learning and talking about these things with you, because when I look at normal these days, if you look at the statistics and just the pulse of what people are going through, normal's not working. If you look, more people have more than ever, but they're unhappy. More people are more connected than ever, but they're lonelier than ever. More people have a look of happiness than ever, but inside are broken and hurting. Our normal is full of convenience and ease, yet we still feel busier and busier and overworked more than ever. Normal just isn't working. We need difference. We need different. So the question we wrestled with throughout this entire series is, what's something that's different about you because of faith? Or how are you different than someone who isn't taking direction from God? And if you're a non-follower of God here, awesome, thanks for checking us out. But maybe your question is, what are normal things that you just feel inside aren't working that you know needs to be different? And no, I'm not thinking cliche church differences, like putting a bumper sticker on your car so everyone knows that you love Jesus. It's not using like the praise hands in your text emoji or texts all the time. It's not like listening to Christian music, like when you roll up to the drive-thru, cranking it up and going on like the Christian radio station, Caleb. And it's not like making sure your kids are on their best behavior when you walk in the church, because we all know that doesn't happen. It's appreciated when they walk in nicely, but we know that doesn't happen. Those aren't the differences I'm referring to. These things, they're not bad to do, but I'm talking different to the core of your being. The difference that we talked about in the series so far was it started with values. Our values should be different. Your values should be holy. You should have a desire to be as holy as you can. And then last week, we talked about how a Jesus follower should have a different perspective in opposition or trials. Like when you're experiencing pushback or opposition and it's dealing with your faith, it probably means you're in the game, you're serving God, you're being different for him. This week, we're talking about being different in your calling or what you feel you are meant to do with your everyday life. Like, what does God want from me? Have you ever wondered that before? Like, what should I do with my everyday life? Like, what should I do with my free time or my days or my free weeks or my months or years? Your calling or how you live your life, it should be different. It should be different as someone who wants to follow God than others in the world. So as we dive in, first off, what is calling? Well, if you just look at a standard definition of calling, the second one says a strong urge towards a particular way of life or career or vocation. As a Christian, when you think of what does that mean, a calling is something you feel God has set forth for you, that you just feel you have to do because you've been gifted in that area. It's something maybe like tattooed or like you just can't get rid of in your heart and in your mind. It's what you feel you're meant to do. To give you an example of this, I really feel I've had this calling since an early age, calling to leadership and discernment. Or in other words, I learned that I'm good at being bossy. Yeah, I did. Yeah, I learned that I'm good at being bossy because those things kind of go with leadership and discernment. But I learned this in even the smallest things, like as I was growing up, and it started years back. It was before I was even serious about my faith, but I knew those were part of my calling. Back in the day, I used to hang out with this close group of guys. We'd all hang out together, and we'd do dinner together a lot. Like there'd be like 8 of us. We'd all go out, have dinner. Now, I lived in Berlin. Does anybody know where Berlin is? It's like a tiny town of 5,000 people. It is tiny. And for dinner, we had 2 choices. It was McDonald's or Clem's Bar. You know, like that was it. Like, and yes, they're on the same street. Yeah, you know Berlin. Yeah. So we'd often make the trip to Oshkosh. We'd go to Oshkosh, and let's just say comparatively, way more options, right? Well, we'd be typical guys. We're driving, and we'd be like, hey, where do you guys want to eat? I don't care. I don't care. Where do you want to eat? I don't care. Where do you want to eat? I don't care. Oh, you see that girl? Oh, I don't care. Like, where do you want to eat? You see, squirrel. You know, like, we'd just be like guys rambling and like no one's making a decision. Well, I was that guy. I started to make the decision. After hearing like other people's suggestions that they throw out, I'd be like, all right, let's do this. Let's go to this place. And it started like as this joke where people would be like, well, wait, why do you get to pick? Is it your birthday or something? And I'd be like, no, I'm just making a decision for us. I've kind of made a consensus, and I'd say, I'm making this decision. Well, we'd do this trip time after time after time, and same thing would happen. And then it would be like, well, it's Aaron's birthday, so let's just let him pick. And it wasn't my birthday. That just became the thing. And I would be assessing the group all the time as I wanted to pick something that I thought all would like. And it often, in Oshkosh, it was Durangos, B-dubs, Beckett's, those were some of our favorites that we went to. Now, some of you right now, you're like, I wish I had Aaron in our car when we're on date night or driving somewhere because I'm going through that all the time too. So email me if you want a decision, by the way. All right. Now, the reason I tell you this is I kind of felt called to be a leader or to be a decision maker that helps all within that group, or at least the majority. Now, me using that gift, since I was good at it for dinner, it's great and all, right? It was good. But I felt there had to be more. There had to be more, a greater use. And that's where we start getting into our callings as someone who is a God follower. It's to be different, to use our calling. It's to be different than what normal people do. It's to be used for God, not for a goal or for self-gain or not for just pleasure or to just survive or to fit in. We are to be different in using our calling. Throughout this series, we've been looking at the book of 1 Peter, and it's been kind of like the core scripture to this series. And as a side note, I challenged like our church, like, read 1 Peter sometime throughout this month, and I got a little special something for you. Just let me know, tell me after the service, but read 1 Peter. You only got like one more week. But the reason we've been using this is Peter talks about being called and staying firm in your faith and using your calling. Now, before we start looking at some of the scripture from 1 Peter and what he says about calling, there's some context you need to know about the book. First off, when Peter's writing this, he is writing to Gentile Christians. And what that means is new Christians, basically. They are new to the idea of being called and to live your life for God, meaning to give up things for God. That's weird. Like, or to make sure that, like, you are trying to, like, live out your faith for God. That's new. So he's speaking to those people in particular. And what he's doing is he's encouraging these people who feel like they're lost, who feel like they're aliens, who feel like they're just different than non-followers of God. So he is encouraging them by saying, you are not normal now. You are like aliens. If you feel that, if you feel like aliens, that's good. You should be different. 1 Peter 2:9, it talks about this. It says, but you are not like that. For you are a chosen people. You are royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of the darkness into his wonderful light. He's saying, you're not like everyone else. You have been called to be God's holy people, and you are to show people that. To show that is to be different in how you use your gifts, your talents, your actions, your comments, your influence, whatever it is. And 1 Peter continues, it talks more about this, it says, for God called you to do good, even if it means suffering, just as Christ suffered for you. And then you're called to do good, it's saying. But then finally, it says, you're also to gain this inheritance. And it says this in 1 Peter 3-4. It says, all praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is by his great mercy that we have been born again because God raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Now we live with great expectation and we have a priceless inheritance, an inheritance that is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change and decay. So we have this God who gives us these gifts, right? We talked about getting gifts from God like a few weeks ago. You should check that out online if you haven't heard that. But then he calls us to do good work in the world, and then he promises us an inheritance. That's what 1 Peter is showing us. Now hearing this, it sounds like Christians, they got it made, right? They got it made. Like, they get sweet gifts, they can do some good in the world, and they have this inheritance for the future. It's like Christians should be these superheroes, like, developing and figuring out what their superpowers are. Like, it makes me think of, like those Marvel movies, like, when they're developing their inner, like, strength or power. Like, I thought of, like, the classic Spider-Man, like, the scene, check it out, like, where he's discovering his talents, and he's just, like, figuring out, what is this gift I've gotten?
Up, up, and away, Web! Shazam! Go! Go! Go, Web, go!
It's like we have these gifts, these things that we think that we, like, we're trying to figure out how to use and want to use them to better ourselves. Yet, there's more to it than that. And if we continue on the Spider-Man theme, what you're actually supposed to use your gifts for is the classic line from the classic Spider-Man.
With great power comes great responsibility.
With great power comes great responsibility, which leads to us being responsible and having others join in that inheritance, that eternity with God. So this word, inheritance, this thing we've been given, if you're a follower of God, that you've been given, it got me thinking, first off, about the fat cash I'm going to get from my relatives. joking. No, but it got me thinking of my all-time favorite Bible story. And it's the story that kind of shows that receiving an inheritance is like a gift or this calling, and we can respond to it differently. It's actually my favorite Bible story, and it's a parable, or it's kind of a figurative story. It's not like something that actually happened. And how the story goes is Jesus tells this story. He tells this story, and it goes, there's this son who has kind of this awkward this conversation with his dad, and he says, hey, I want that money, that gift that you're going to give me that you'll give me when you die. I kind of want that. Will you give that to me? And the father's honorable and says, like, you know what? Sure, I guess I'll give that to you. So it says he goes off and he spends his money on reckless living. And honestly, that reckless living is normal, crazy things that we all have probably done, like wild things, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, minus the rock and roll part, but like all, like doing those things that like are kind of normal bad things. And what happens is he runs out of money as he's spending these things on, and he's kind of on his own. He ends up having to work for a pigs farmer, and he's hardly having enough money to buy food, so he looks at the pig's food and he's about to eat it, and he has this moment of revelation. And I'll actually read it for you. It's in Luke 15, 17. It says, when he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, at home, even the hired servants have food enough to spare. And here I am, dying of hunger. So the son goes home, expecting to be the servant for his father. But things turn out differently than he was expecting. His father embraces him, welcomes him back, throws a party for him. Now, this part of the story, I love it. I love it because I can so identify with that younger son. Like, I've had my rough time literally living recklessly, but then also like using my God-given inheritance or gifts, my inheritance of leadership and decision-making for things not so great, to plan epic parties, to lead people to making poor decisions, to for my own self-gain. I've used those gifts for that. I found my spot where I was like that younger son. This is meaningless. I can throw epic parties, but it's done and over. Now what? Now what? There has to be more. There's got to be something better. There's got to be something different. And I slowly like found that I had a greater use when I was connected to God using that calling. But the story, it doesn't stop there. There's another son too. This elder son who stays back as this younger son goes away, stays back. He slaves away at home, doesn't do anything wrong. He's waiting patiently for his inheritance. And he hears his brother's back, and there's this party, and he's mad. He's mad. I'll read this one for you. It's in verse 28, and it says, the older brother was angry and wouldn't go in. His father came out and begged him, but he replied, all these years I've slaved for you and never once refused to do a single thing you told me to do. And in all that time, you never gave me even one young goat for a feast with my friends. Yet when this son of yours comes back after squandering your money on prostitutes, you celebrate by killing the fattened calf. His father said to him, look, dear son, you have always stayed by me, and everything I have is yours. We had to celebrate this happy day, for your brother was dead and has come back to life. He was lost, but he is found. And the story just ends there. These days, right now, I find myself relating more with that elder son. I've done a lot of work. I've stayed true. I've stayed the course. I've sacrificed, and I've worked my butt off. I'm good, right? I've pushed. I've used my skills or effort for things. I don't know if I want to use my skill and effort for those people or for that situation. A second chance for someone? Nah, I'm good. I'm tired. I've worked. It makes me think, what should my energy and talents go to? Now, both these characters, they had an inheritance, had a gift, had a calling. The younger son, he took his inheritance and spent it realizing he was living for pleasure and his desires, and it eventually got old. The older son waited for his inheritance, expected to just play it safe, not really out there risking and waiting to see his own return, but didn't get what he was hoping for. Can you relate to one of these guys? as I'm preparing for a message, I leave myself, I get like thoughts and I'll like type it in my phone and put it in like notes. And here's like a screenshot of like one that's just been like stirring in my brain. I know you can't read it, so I'll read it for you. But it's just like, when I get these thoughts, and this is what I wrote down as I was studying this story. It says, the younger son didn't realize he was called for something more, and the older son didn't realize he was called for something different. The younger son didn't realize he was called for something more, and the older son didn't realize he was called for something different, better, God-honoring. Again, which one do you relate with? The reason this story is prevalent when we talk about calling and when we talk about 1 Peter and being different is normal, is getting sucked into one of those two options. Either waiting for things to happen and being mad when they don't happen to you, or going off using things in a poor manner. Again, if you're a follower of God or someone who's curious about God, you're called to be different, to live differently. 1 Peter, it talks about what he means by this calling. It's in 1 Peter 4:2. It says, you won't spend the rest of your lives chasing your own desires, but you will be anxious to do the will of God. Again, he's encouraging these people, saying, you should be anxious to do the will of God. You were called to live for God, for his purposes, for his direction. You should be anxious to spend your inheritance, your gift, your calling towards God, not wanting to wait and not spending it recklessly. Do you have a desire for that? If you do, that's different. That's the difference Peter is calling for from us. Not for selfish pleasures of what the young son chased after, but also not for normal, safe living of the elder son. You are called to live for God, to use your gifts, time, talents, and skills. That is not normal. So what are you called to be when it comes to different? This weekend, my wife and Sydney and my little girl, Eliza, they were away this weekend. They're still gone, actually. They had to go to their hometown, or my wife's hometown for a baby shower. Anyways, it was amazing. It was amazing. So I got to go in the bed early, having a beer, watching random shows on Netflix this weekend, and I stumbled upon a new show that's called Last Chance University. Again, my weekend was amazing, but this show, it was really interesting. It's really good, and my weekend was awesome, right? But the show pointed some things out to me. Has anybody ever heard of this show? Like, it's called Last Chance U. Yeah, okay. So I'm talking about specifically the basketball one. And there's just this amazing clip that I think fits so well for what we're talking about today. The show, again, it's called Last Chance U. And what it's all about, if you've never heard of it before, it's about these college-age basketball players that are so close to a D1 scholarship. But they just struggle with something. Like, they had a mishap happen in their life. They don't have the grades, or they're just not quite good enough, but they're almost there. So they're at their last chance. They're at this junior college, this community college, or this college with the sole intention to get them to their next college. So the coach there pushes them like crazy. Pushes them like crazy. I want to give you a little preview of the show before we watch the clip I'm talking about, but it's intense, so check it out.
Don't put on a show. You win the game. Don't put on a show. Freaking win the game.
Welcome to East Los Angeles College Huskies basketball.
Let's get it up.
For us, JUCO, we trying to get to that next level.
I want to be a D1 player so bad.
It's not what you would think. It's not Hollywood for sure.
If they can go on to someplace else and get a scholarship, then their world changes significantly.
So that's kind of like a recap of the show. The coach is intense. He's pushing his players to be the best they can, to improve, to be better, to maybe get to be this D1 player. That's his intention. That's his goal as a coach. And the coach's name is John. So he's passionate about getting these players to the next level. There's a time where he explains why he does what he does. And this is what was powerful to me. So listen to what his comments are towards the end. Check it out.
1 month, man. Can you do it? For you. Forgive me. It's for you. You gotta play the right way to get what you want. Unless you're trying to self-sabotage. Golly, man. Don't you want it? Don't you want it? You should be a competitor. Ball's there. He ain't going nowhere. What else do you want? What 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 do you want?
You ain't got no scholarship right now.
The kids like a Marquise, the kids like a Taj, all the end of the bench kids, they really need this opportunity. And so he's thinking about that.
There's really no understanding it unless you're in these shoes, unless you're in John's shoes. I've been to the Division I level. There's no doubt in my mind that junior college level is harder from a coaching standpoint. John's a Division I coach. He could be a Division I head coach right now.
I've never been one for, you know, trying to go to the dance or the big show. I want to be where God calls me to be. I want to be where I'm probably most needed.
Starkey! Starkey! Starkey!
I had an opportunity to coach Division I, and it was hard to be authentic. I do have the opportunity to be authentic here and have a lasting impact on kids' life that nobody wants to give a second chance to.
So there's some really powerful lines in that clip that stuck out to me. He said something so great. He said, I have to be authentic. Are you being authentic for God with your calling, your gifts? If you're gifted by God, called by God, are you authentic and doing good for him, living out your calling? He also said, I have a desire to be where I am needed. I don't know about you. That tends to go hand in hand with calling. Like, why would God call you to something or give you a particular gift for something if it's not needed? What's a need, a place where you can help, you can serve, an area that you have a passion for, a thing that stirs around in your brain that you just can't shake sometimes, this thing that you just know God wants you to act on? For you, is it a ministry in the church? Maybe you're just so passionate about teens or men's or women's or kids or worship or whatever it is. Is it coaching for you? Like you want to help kids get to a level where they feel confident and enjoy life because of sports? Is it a big brother, big sister? You're helping kids feel connected. Is it spending time in a nursing home? You want to serve with the elderly, you just have a passion for that? Or is it serving amongst the city, this community, or volunteering in a place? Is it coordinating things? Is it using a specific gift you have to lead, to teach, to help, to care, to listen? What's your gift and what's your calling? What is it? What are you called to do for God? What is it you can do that's different, but it feels so right that God has created you for it, that called you for it? A big part of calling that I think we tend to think about is job or career, right? It has to be this job or career. And absolutely, a calling can be a career, but it shouldn't ever become the only way you live out a calling. A calling can be something you do besides your career. You can live for your calling in more than where you work. It's not about what you do for a job. Honestly, I've fallen into this trap and I'm still wrestling with it today. Like, for me, again, I realized my calling was kind of to lead and be a decision maker. And being a pastor kind of fits into that mold. It fits into that. And what I do is, like, part of being a pastor is I do different things. Like, I think I'm an okay speaker. I think I'm good at, like, organizing a service, helping people get connected to God and church. Being a leader and a decision maker, I think that's what God wants me to do. But I go through times where, like, I don't focus on that as the calling, and I focus on other things as a calling, like where my mind tries to sway me from that side of the calling to making sure everyone laughs on Sunday. That's my calling, is to be funny, or to make sure I have the perfect sermon, or the best Sunday service amongst all places, or I'm not called to those things. I'm not called to do those things. I'm called to lead. I'm called to be a pastor. I'm called to be that decision maker. And I get slowly pulled into that. I also believe just as important as being a pastor is fulfilling my call to lead and decide things is also at home. At home. Like, to be a good husband, I'm called to take care of Sydney. I've committed to loving Sydney. So how do I love her? I care for her. I forgive her. I touch her the way she likes it, which is not sexual. I give her time. I give her my time, and I make sure that my calling is to care for her and to lead our home. But it's not to, like, have this best marriage or the best pictures on Instagram. And then I slowly start to creep into thinking that's my calling. And same thing, I feel like I'm called to be a father. Like, I'm called to lead it as a father, as a parent. I'm not the most coolest, most trendy dad that knows everything, but I'm called to be Eliza's father. I believe I'm called to be a son, a grandson, a community contributor, a servant of God, and again, a leader, decision maker, and focusing on those things, but not getting pulled into some of the superficial things. My calling is these, but not one that has success or pleasure tied to it. It's one that it's supposed to be lived out and ultimately led by God, but one I'm responsible for. What is it for you? What is your calling to be different in the world that God has placed you in? Your calling and the way you live should make you different. As we wrap up today, what does that look like for you? Maybe you're like the younger son in our story, and you realize you need to get to a place of holiness, not chasing worldly things, not using your gifts for only your own gain or your own pleasure. God has called you back to use your inheritance for something more than yourself. If that's you, tell God that. Tell God, I want to be used by you. I know I've messed up in the past. I know you've gifted me with things. I trust your forgiveness. Help me find my calling and do it for you. Help me use my calling in a way that grows your reach. And you're on your path of being a follower of God. Maybe you're like the older son, though. You're like the older son, and you need to get to this place where you aren't working for normal. You're not doing just the normal stuff, which is safe, busy, being expectant of things. That you actually need to put yourself out there. You need to use your gifts. You have great power. Where are you using it? Where are you needed? Where can you be authentic for you? Again, is it in the church? Is it in, there's tons of spots that you can serve in. Is it outside the church? Is it in the community? Raising your kids at home? Is it with your spouse? Is it at Big Brothers, Big Sisters? Wherever it is for you, where are you called to use your gifts to be different? What is a gift you have and a calling that uses that gift that's both different and God-honoring? Think about that. Act on that. I'm going to pray that we are different in how we use our gifts and how we see our calling. If you want God to help you do that and help you be aware of that this week, you can pray along with me. Dear Heavenly Father, I'm praying right now for some of us. We know that you've gifted us with certain things. And God, we've gone different paths of being like the younger son and the older son. But God, right now, we want to be different. We want to live for you. We want to use our calling for you to be authentic. Remind us of how to do that. Show us what we should use those gifts, those callings for, and help us act on them, do them. Do the good works you've set forth for us. God, I just pray that you have those things happen and have us be more and more aware of those this week. In your name we pray. Amen. A couple quick announcements. First off, we're going to be taking an offering in a second. If you're just visiting or checking out church, please don't feel obligated to give. But if this is your church home, I want to encourage you to give during that time. If you believe in our mission of helping people take their next step in their relationship with God, that also is a great opportunity to support that as well. You can put those connect cards in the offering bins if you filled out one of those. I send out a pretty great email each week, so if you want that, fill out that card, drop it in the bin. And then also, we have Easter coming up. Easter's a pretty big deal in the church world. So Easter we're really excited about. We have three services, so three service times. Easter's a really big deal because a lot of people are willing to check out church for the first time or just because there's this holiday tied to it. So let's use that for good. Let's invite our friends, our family members, our coworkers. So take those invite cards in front of you. Take those with you. I don't want any more in the seats. Take them with you. Give them away. Grab more. Grab all of them, whatever you need. But invite people. And we have three services. So Saturday we're doing an egg hunt at 5 p.m. and the service is at 6 p.m. The goal is to bring to have families come and have a ton of fun. Like, do an egg hunt. There'll be pizza. There'll be cornhole. And it'll be a ton of fun Saturday night. Kids get to play in the museum. All that's happening Saturday at 5 o'clock. And then at 6 o'clock, it'll go to the service. So the services are the same as Sunday. So that could be a really great option for families and for kids. So check that out. And then Sunday, we have two services at 9 and 10:30. Again, invite some friends. It's going to be a really great service. I'm super excited about it. With that said, I'm going to hand it off to the band.
Just stand up and join us, guys. A couple songs here. Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy, come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of its goodness, find what you're looking for. But God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Bring all your failures, bring your addiction, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms. See his open arms. To God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. It's a power. God so loved the world. Bring it down. So praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, for the wonders of His love. Come on. Praise God. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, for the wonders of His love, of His love. God so loved, come on, the love that He gave us, His one and only Son to save us. Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world. Oh. We got one last song here, and it's a new one. But is there K-Love listeners, anybody out there? I mean, besides when you're waiting. Awesome, because then you know this song, because it's completely blowing up. New one. David Crowder, this it's on all the time, but it's so great. It's a perfect earworm. My job is to make you sing it in your head for the rest of the week. But there's one thing going on here, though. There's a little call and response, and I need you guys. These guys won't sing for me. They won't. I don't know what the deal is. They won't sing for me. So you guys. So if I go, tell me he is good, you go, he's good. He's God. That's your part. Ready? I'm going to try this one here. He is good. He is God. Awesome. Great God Almighty. That's what it's going to be like, okay? You're in the band now. Okay. I'm sorting this out a little myself right now. Good God Almighty. Again, that's going to be in your head all week, right? We're going to keep that on the list, right? Yes, we are. Thank you guys so much for coming out. Have a great and glorious day out there. It's beautiful. Be out there. Grab some snacks on your way. Talk to people you don't know.
Thank you so much for checking out a service at CenterPoint. We hope you enjoyed it, and we hope you have something that you can take this week and use in your life. Here at CenterPoint, our mission is to help you take your next step in your relationship with God. If that's something you believe in and would like to support, you can support the mission of CenterPoint by going online to centerpointfdl.com and pressing the Give button. Again, thank you so much for coming and checking out a service, and we hope to see you back next week.